Okay, so the work done is positive in case of turbines. So the work done is negative in case of compressor. Whatever we concluded that chapter, compressor work done is negative. And on the other hand, we are having certain devices. There is neither work done nor work absorbing. For example, your nozzle. So what is a nozzle? Nozzle is a device mainly used to increase the velocity of working fluid. There is work is done is zero. Okay, so nozzle, in this class we are going to discuss the nozzle. Okay, just a minute, sir. So I'm sharing the screen, okay, of nozzles. Okay, friends, are you able to see the contents on the screen? Steam nozzle.
Yes, sir.
First, you should know what is a nozzle. Okay, nozzle is a tube or pipe of varying cross section through which, okay, through which the steam is allowed to flow, where the heat energy is converted into your the kinetic energy. Okay, so whatever diagram shows, it is a convergent nozzle. So decreasing in the area, this is called as inlet and this is called as the outlet. We know that the steam is generated in the boiler, which is having the high pressure and low velocity steam is generated in the boiler. Okay, so we have to increase the velocity. In that case, we are going to use the nozzle. Okay, so when high pressure, low velocity steam enters inside the nozzle, then what? The expansion process happens. In the expansion, the pressure decreases. Okay, and due to this expansion, the low velocity steam is increased to high velocity steam. So we'll get the low pressure, high velocity steam is coming out from your nozzle. So this is the nozzle, means it increases the kinetic energy or the velocity of working fluid with the expense of pressure energy. That is the function of nozzle. Okay, so in case of nozzle, the velocity of working fluid will be increased. Okay, so next type of nozzle. Mainly there are two types of nozzle. One is convergent nozzle and second one is convergent divergent nozzle. There are mainly two types. Okay, in case of convergent nozzle, the cross sectional area is decreases from the entry to the exit, as you see in the diagram one. So as the pressure drops takes place, we know that there is no work done. Work done does not there in case of nozzle. Hence, all the pressure energy is converted into kinetic energy. We are having the only the decreasing cross sectional area in case of convergent nozzle. Okay. On the other hand, you can see the second diagram here. Okay. Okay, in case of convergent divergent nozzle, okay, starting we are having the convergent part. Okay, from entry to throat section, the area where cross section is minimum, that is called as throat section. Okay, next after that it diverges, that is the area increases from throat to exit in case of convergent divergent nozzle, whereas in case of convergent nozzle there is no throat. Okay, only the decreasing cross sectional area. So convergent divergent nozzle, we are having the convergent part, next throat section, and then exit section. Okay, so this is the two types of a nozzle. Then how the flow flows through a nozzle. Okay, we are having one simple expression. Okay, how the flow flows. Okay, we are taking the convergent nozzle. Okay, flow of steam through the nozzle. As we know that the steam is coming out from the exit of nozzle is having the low pressure and high velocity. Okay, so next we have to obtain that expression for the exit velocity. Here we are concentrating on velocity rather than your pressure. Okay, how to derive the exit velocity? Let P1 is your the inlet pressure. Okay, and C1 is the velocity of steam at inlet. Okay, you can use either V1 or C1. Sometimes C1 is also used in place of V1 to represent the velocity. P1 is pressure of steam at nozzle entry, C1 is the velocity of steam at nozzle entry, and H1 is enthalpy of steam at inlet. Okay, we know that the whatever the steam coming out of the boiler contains the enthalpy. Enthalpy is nothing but the heat content of the system. We know that enthalpy is given by the formula H equals to U plus PV, where U is internal energy plus P and V are pressure and volume respectively. You remember the formula H equals to U plus PV. You studied in a steady flow energy equation enthalpy. Okay, so PC1 are pressure, velocity, and enthalpy of steam at inlet to the nozzle. You remember it is a convergent nozzle where the cross sectional area decreases from entry to the exit. Okay, so after expansion, so that as the area decreases, so that the velocity increases, pressure decreases, the velocity increases. Let P2 C2 and H2 are the pressure, the velocity and enthalpy of steam at exit. Okay, these are the parameters related to inlet and exit of the nozzle. Now, so you studied steady flow energy equation in BTD. So what is the steady flow energy equation? H1 plus V1 square by 2 or C1 square by 2 plus W plus R minus Q depending upon the application equals to H plus V C2 square by 2 plus Q. Okay, here there is no work done. Okay, this is the steady flow energy equation. What you studied? H plus V1 square by 2 plus Z plus W equals to H2 plus V2 square by 2 plus Z2 plus Q, whatever equation you studied in BTD. Same thing we are applying here. H1 plus C1 square by 2 plus W, whatever Q is there, no, we took here left-hand side, equals to H2 plus C2 square divided by 2. Okay, as we know that the nozzle is neither work absorbing device nor work producing device, so W will be 0. And heat transfer is also 0 because suppose if it is insulated, there will be no heat transfer at all. So only you are going to concentrate on velocity and enthalpy here. Okay, so W is 0, Q is 0, and so these two are all 0. Then you rewrite once again. H1 plus C1 square by 2 equals to H2 plus C2 square divided by 2. Okay. Because you have to neglect these two terms. Only you have to concentrate on enthalpy and your the velocity of fluid. Okay. So C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2. After simplifying, you'll get this equation. C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2 equals to H1 minus H2. So H1 minus H2 means what? Obviously, there will be a change in enthalpy takes place. The heat content will be high at the inlet and heat content will be less in case of exit. So there will be enthalpy decrease takes place from inlet to outlet. That is nothing but your H1 minus H2. So next you simplify. C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2 equals to H1 minus H2, or we are calling this H1 minus H2 as. Are you seeing the content?
No, sir.
You are not seeing the screen. Okay.
First, you can just see type or shape of some.
Okay. I'll say, okay. Now, are you able to see the contents on the screen, guys? Are you able to?
No, it's the same screen. Yes, sir. Now I can see.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, can see now. No, I'm scrolling. Are you able to see? Scrolling.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, good.
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. Now, I'm going to derive the expression for flow through the nozzle. Okay. So, how we are going to find out the velocity at the exit of the nozzle? Okay, as I said, convergent nozzle where the cross-sectional area is decreasing from inlet to outlet. Okay, and parameters, P1 is your inlet pressure, whatever pressure of steam entering at section 1, and C1 is what? The velocity of the steam entering, and H1 is what? Enthalpy. Okay, enthalpy means your heat content of the fluid. Next, then as it enters inside the nozzle, the pressure decreases. Remember, expansion process happens. As the pressure decreases, the velocity increases. So we'll have the high velocity at the exit. Similarly, P2 is the pressure at exit of the nozzle. C2 is the velocity at the exit of the nozzle, and H2 is your enthalpy at the exit of the nozzle. Just you remember these six terms, P1, C1 and H1. C1 is nothing but velocity, or you can use Okay, P1 is inlet pressure, C1 is your the velocity. You can represent either V1 or C1, both are same. H1 is enthalpy at inlet, P2, C2 and H2 are pressure, velocity and enthalpy at the exit. Okay, so you studied steady flow energy equation in BTD. What is steady flow energy equation? I hope you remember. H1 plus V1 square by 2 plus Z1 plus W equals to H2 plus V2 square by 2 plus Z2 plus your Q. Okay, the same thing we are applying here, and we are going to neglect the certain terms. I derived this derivation in BTD also. So once again, I am repeating. Okay. So what is the formula? H1 plus C1 square or V1 square by 2 plus W equals to H2 plus C2 square divided by 2 plus Q. Okay. Next, as I said, nozzle is neither work producing nor work absorbing a device. So W will be zero. On the other hand, Q is also zero because there is no heat transfer takes place in nozzle. Only the pressure energy is converted into your kinetic energy. So you have to neglect W and Q in this equation. So after neglecting these two terms, we'll get H1 plus C1 square by 2 equals to H2 plus C2 square divided by 2 because we're neglecting W and Q. Okay, same thing. I am writing here H1 plus C1 square by 2 equals to H2 plus C2 square divided by 2. Then after simplification, C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2 equals to H1 minus H2. Okay. Because in case of nozzle, so whatever the heat content of the steam at inlet is very high. As it processes through the nozzle, the pressure decreases and also the enthalpy decreases from inlet to outlet. That is H1 minus H2 is nothing but your enthalpy drop, and it is represented by symbol HD. HD means enthalpy drop. So C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2 equals to HD, or C2 square minus C1 square equals to 2 times HD. Okay, you remember HD is nothing but H1 minus H2. Okay, and as I said, the velocity at the exit is so high that the elasticity at the inlet will be neglect, because suppose you are having 2000 meter per second at exit, and if it is only 2 meter per second at inlet, then in that case, the value of C1 is far less as compared to C2. Then we are going to neglect that velocity. So we are going to consider the only velocity at outlet of the nozzle. Okay, now you C1, you neglect the term because the velocity at inlet is too less as compared to the velocity at exit. So C2 square equals to 2 times HD plus C1 square. Okay, so this is the C2. C1 you neglect it. Okay, so only you are getting C2 square equals to 2 times HD, or C2 is nothing but square root of, no, because this one, as I'll repeat once again here, as I said, nozzle is a velocity increasing device. Okay, suppose we consider the velocity at inlet is around 10 meter per second. Okay, it is 1000 times greater at the exit. Around, suppose if it is 4 meter per second, means we'll get around 4000 meter per second. In that case, the velocity at point one is far less as compared to the velocity at exit. Means C1 is far less than even the velocity at exit. Okay, so because nozzle is a pressure decreasing and velocity increasing device, the velocity at the inlet is too small as compared to the velocity at exit. For that purpose, you have to neglect this term C1. Understood? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2 equals to HD. So C1 becomes 0. Then what you'll get in the equation? C2 square equals to 2 times HD. HD is nothing but what? H1 minus H2. So C2 square equals to 2 times HD, or C2 is what? A square root of 2 into H1 minus H2. Okay. So this is a formula what we are getting. We derived in the BTD also. And suppose if we express enthalpy in terms of kilojoules, in that case, just you multiply by 1000. Otherwise, just you put as it is square root of H1 minus H2. Okay. 2000 means what? 1000 is we are going to put the enthalpy in terms of kilojoules per kg. Remember, okay. Don't this one. Think any much this one. 1000 is your conversion of enthalpy into kilojoules, that is square root of 2000 into H1 minus H2 when you express enthalpy in kilojoules. Okay, square root of 2000, you'll get some value. That is a formula, very simple formula. And sometimes in the problem they'll give, okay, you consider inlet velocity. In that case, you have to consider this one. Okay, otherwise you have to neglect this value. Okay, this is the expression for enthalpy. That is what, just you remember, C2 equals to what? C2 square equals to 2 times HD, or 2 times H1 minus H2. C2 equals to square root of 2 into H1 minus H2. Suppose we express in terms of kilojoules for enthalpy, that is nothing but square root of 2000 into H1 minus H2. So this expression gives the velocity at exit neglecting inlet velocity. If the inlet velocity is considered, then you have to consider that term. Then how will get? C2 square equals to C1 square plus 2 times HD, or that becomes in the square root. Okay. That is C2 equals to square root of 2000 into H1 minus H2 plus C1 square when you considered inlet velocity into the account. If C1 is 0, in that case this term becomes 0. These are the two simple formula you should remember for the velocity of the steam at the exit of the nozzle. Okay, only two equation, that is C2 is square root of 2 into H1 minus H2, or where H1 is enthalpy at inlet, unit is kilojoules, H2 is enthalpy at exit. Okay, and one more important derivation, okay, we are going to do is your condition for maximum discharge. Okay, this is the one of the important derivation in steam nozzle. We are having only one derivation. Just you go through this derivation properly, try to understand, because this derivation carries 10 marks. Okay, that is they'll ask, derive an expression for condition for maximum discharge or critical pressure ratio. Okay. As I said, in the case of nozzle, we are having very high velocity. Because of a high velocity, we'll get the maximum discharge. I think you studied in fluid mechanics. So the expression for discharge is what? Q equals to A into V. Okay, so Q is directly proportional to velocity. Okay, you are having continuity equation in fluid mechanics. Okay, Q equals to AV. As the velocity increases, the discharge also increases. Hence, the nozzles are always designed for maximum discharge. Okay, as the velocity increases, the discharge also increases. Now, our aim is to find out how we'll get the maximum discharge in case of nozzle. Okay. Okay, for this one also, you consider convergent nozzle only for derivation of this one. What is a convergent nozzle? As I explained here, you have to draw this diagram, convergent nozzle only, and you have to write the values P1, C1 and H1 at inlet, P2, C2 and H2 at outlet. P, C and H are the pressure, velocity and enthalpy at inlet and outlet respectively. Okay. Next. Okay, I think you studied mass balance in steady flow equation. Okay, in steady flow energy equation, we are doing two things. One is mass balance and second one is energy balance. What is mass balance? That is mass flow rate throughout the structure remains same. Okay, that is nothing but m equals to a2 into v2 divided by V2. Okay, so don't make confusion here. C is your velocity and V is your volume. That is product of the area and velocity divided by volume. That gives your the mass flow rate. How will get kg per second? Means A is in meter square, C is in meter per second, and V is in the meter cube. Okay, so after this one we'll get the kg per second, because meter square get cancelled. We'll get the unit of m as kg per second. So this is the formula for mass flow rate. You remember this is the mass balance, product of area and velocity to the volume. So A2 is here, we are not considering A1 and C1 because that is not important. Our aim is to find out the velocity at exit. For that purpose, always you have to take the condition at outlet. Okay, because the condition at one, that is at point one, are not important, because we'll get the highest velocity at point two. That's why you have to take mass flow rate as A2 into C2 divided by V2. Okay. Okay. Next. Okay, where A2 is cross-sectional area, C2 is the velocity at nozzle exit, and V2 is your volume of 1 kg. That is your specific volume in meter cube per kg. Okay. Now, in the derivation, what we did, so in case of nozzle, the pressure energy is converted into kinetic energy. So whatever the gain in kinetic energy is nothing but drop in enthalpy. As I said, the pressure decrease takes place, there will be decrement in the enthalpy. We are having the highest enthalpy at 0.1 and lowest enthalpy at 0.2. So gain in kinetic energy equals to drop in enthalpy. Okay. So what is the gain in kinetic energy? Kinetic energy at 0.2 is nothing but your V2 square divided by 2. Okay. Drop in enthalpy. Drop in enthalpy is nothing but your work done during this cycle. I'll explain Rankine cycle in vapor power cycle, that is module 3. Okay, just you remember, the enthalpy is nothing but the work done during the cycle. Work done during the cycle is always your polytropic work done, like in your compressor. Okay, so drop in enthalpy is nothing but the work done during the polytropic process. Always it is polytropic. As I said, we are not considering isothermal or adiabatic. The polytropic is the one which gives the maximum result. Okay, that's why we have to consider the polytropic process. Just you remember, whatever kinetic energy equals to drop in enthalpy. Drop in enthalpy is always equals to the work done. Okay, this term I'll explain in a vapor power cycle. Okay, just for this moment, you remember, drop in enthalpy is nothing but work done during the particular cycle. Rankine cycle is a steam power cycle that comes in vapor power cycle. So C2 square divided by 2 equals to N divided by N minus 1 into P1 V1 minus P2 V2. This is the expression for work done during polytropic process. Okay. C2 square by 2 equals to N divided by N minus 1. And here in this equation, you take P1 V1 outside. Okay. Just you remember LHS term and RHS term. LHS is your whatever increase in the velocity at 0.2, and RHS term is just work done in the polytropic process. Okay. C2 square by 2 equals to N divided by N minus 1. Here in this equation, I am taking P1 V1 outside. Suppose you take P1 V1 outside, in the bracket, what you'll get? 1 minus P2 V2 divided by P1 V1. So you call it as equation number 2. Okay. Equation number 1 is your the mass flow rate. That is M equals to A2 C2 divided by V2 is your equation number 1. And equation number 2 is your C2 square by 2 equals to N divided by N minus 1 into P1 V1 into 1 minus P2 V2 divided by P1 V1. As I said, whatever the steam flows through the nozzle follows the polytropic process. So what is the polytropic law? PV raised to N equals to constant. Already studied this equation where P is pressure, V is volume, and N is called your polytropic index equals to C. Okay. Because of the polytropic process, then you have to apply for state 1 and state 2. So P1 V1 to the power of N equals to P2 V2 to the power of N for polytropic process. And from this equation, I can write V2 by V1 equals to P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N. How will get? V2 by V1 to the power of N equals to P1 by P2. And you have to divide the power by N. After dividing the power only, you will get this expression. V2 by V1 equals to P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N. Okay. So why you are finding means we are going to substitute this value V2 by V1 in equation number 2. Okay. So now you have to substitute the value of V2 by V1, what we are getting from equation number 3 in equation number 2. Okay. So write C2 square by 2 as it is, N divided by N minus 1 as it is, P1 V1 as it is, in the bracket 1 minus this P2 by P1 also as it is. Just you replace the term V2 by V1 equals to P1 by P2 in this equation, because we have to express in the same unit. That's why we are substituting this value. Okay. So we are expressing the ratio V2 by V1 in terms of P1 by P2. You have to substitute the value of V2 by V1 from equation number 3 in equation number 2. Okay. And the next step is, okay. So C2 square by 2 equals to N divided by N minus 1 into P1 V1 and 1 minus. Okay. So here we are having P2 by P1, but here we are having P1 by P2. So how we are going to write P2 by P1? You can write this term as P2 by P1 to the power of minus 1 by N. Both are having same meaning. Then after that, you have to apply the law of index. What is that law of index? P2 by P1 to the power of 1 minus 1 by N. 1 minus 1 by N means what? 1 minus 1 by N is nothing but your PN minus 1 divided by N. Just you simplify this one. Apply law of index. That is x to the power of A into x to the power of B is nothing but x to the power of A plus B. Okay. So here N divided by N minus 1 P1 V1 into 1 minus P2 by P1 to the power of N minus 1 divided by N after simplifying this equation. Now here C2 square by 2 is there. Now I am going to find out, my aim is to find out only C2. Then what is C2? C2 is square root of, you take 2 inside the square root, 2 into N divided by N minus 1 into P1 V1 in the bracket 1 minus P2 divided by P1 to the power of N minus 1 divided by N. So this is C2 square by 2. So now after simplifying, you'll get the expression of C2 as square root of 2 into N divided by N minus 1 P1 V1 into 1 minus P2 by P1 to the power of N minus 1 divided by N. So I hope you understood this equation, equation number 4. Okay. All of you understood? Okay, next, from equation number 3. Okay, what is equation number 3? V2 by V1 equals to P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N. It's nothing but V2 equals to what? V1 into P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N. Just you replace V1 towards right hand side. That is nothing but your V2. Now what I am going to do, so you are having the equation number 1. What is the equation number 1? Your mass flow rate, okay, A2 C2 divided by V2. Now we got the expression for C2 in equation number 4. Now next step is you have to, and V2 is what? Here we got the expression for C2 from equation number 4, and V2, we got this equation, that is volume at the point 2 is given by V1 into this one. You refer this equation, V2 by V1 equals to P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N, or V2 equals to V1 into P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N. Now we have to substitute the value of V2 from equation number 5 and also the value of C2 from equation number 4 in equation number 1, that is M equals to A2 C2 divided by V2. Substituting the value of C2 and V2 from equation number 4 and 5 in equation number 1. Okay, so that is nothing but M equals to A2 as it is into C2 is what? Just you put this term here, A2 into square root of 2 into N divided by N minus 1, P1 V1 in the bracket 1 minus P2 by P1 to the power of N minus 1 divided by N. And how about V2, that numerator? V2 is nothing but your V1 into P1 by P2 to the power of 1 by N. Okay, this is the what value is for mass flow rate. A2 into C2 divided by V2. Okay. Now, in the next step, you refer this step. Okay. So you write LHS as it is, and then A2 divided by V1. Then what I'm going to take? So instead of writing P1 by P2 to the power of N, this is in denominator. Next here, I am going to take in numerator this term. Okay, so in that case, when you shift the term, so instead of P1 by P2, you can write it as P2 by P1. You observe carefully here, P1 by P2 is there. It is in denominator. I am taking in numerator. When you take the numerator, you have to change the term. Like instead of P1 by P2, just you write it as P2 by P1 to the power of 1 by N, and in the bracket, okay, you have to write the equation what is there in the square root as it is, 2 into N divided by N minus 1 P1 V1 into 1 minus P2 by P1 to the power of 1 minus 1 divided by N. Okay, so what I'm doing here means just I'm taking, so rewriting the equation, that's it. Okay, next, in this step, okay, what I am doing, I am taking this P2 by P1 outside, inside the square root. In that case, what? So suppose 4, you are going to take inside the square root. What you are doing? You are writing square root of 16 is nothing but your 4, like that. When you are taking this term inside the square root, just you have to multiply by 2. Okay, for example, square. Suppose if I want to take 9 inside a square root, how you are going to write 9 equals to square root of 81. Okay, like that, same thing, you have to take that term inside the square root. That is A2 by A1, you write as it is square root of 2 into N divided by N minus 1, P1 V1 as it is. And suppose if you take inside the square root, instead of writing 1 by N, just you have to write 2 by N. You remember this number is 2. Okay, P2 by P1 to the power of 2 by N. This one I took inside the square root. In the bracket, you write as it is. In this step, what I'm doing means just taking this term inside the square root. That's it, nothing else. Okay, and in the next step, A2 by V1 square root of 2 into N divided by N minus 1 you put as it is. P1 V1 is also put as it is. Then what I am going to do, just I am going to take this inside the bracket, means multiplying. So how then you have to simplify this one. How we are going to simplify? So 2 into N divided by N minus 1 as it is, P1 V1 in the bracket, P2 by P1 to the power of 2 by N, means you are taking inside, minus of product of these two. Okay, just I am taking inside the bracket. It is nothing but X into 1 minus Y. It is nothing but what? x minus xy, same thing. Okay, so here just you take inside the bracket and you simplify. This is a simplification. So a2 by v1 as it is, square root of 2 into n divided by n minus 1, p1 v1 as it is, just you have to simplify this one. You'll get p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n minus of product of these two, p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n into p2 by p1 to the power of n minus 1 divided by n. So here you see, once again you have to apply law of index. That is nothing but x to the power of a into x to the power of b. That is nothing but x to the power of a plus b. Just you take the same term, and in the index, just you have to add the index term. Okay, a2 by v1 square root of 2 into n divided by n minus 1 as it is, p1 v1 as it is, and in the bracket. So this is also as it is. We are not going to do with this term. Only you have to add the index. What is the index? 2 by n plus n minus 1 divided by n. Okay, so what is the addition after simplifying? We'll get 2 by n plus n divided, n minus 1 divided by n. N is common in the denominator. 2 plus n minus 1 means what? N minus 1 only you'll get. So in this bracket, after simplifying, you'll get p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n minus of p2 by p1 to the power of n minus 1 divided by n. So you call this equation as 6. Okay. I hope you understood up to this point. Just you are rearranging the term and you are getting one expression, that is m equals to a2 by v1 square root of 2 into n divided by n minus 1 p1 v1 in the bracket p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n minus of p2 by p1 to the power of n minus 1 divided by n. So equation number 6 gives the expression for the velocity at exit in the case of convergent nozzle. You remember, whatever the nozzle we considered here is convergent nozzle. Okay. And so mainly which term is most important here? So it is depends upon your area. And one more important term is your pressure ratio. What is pressure ratio? The pressure at exit divided by pressure at inlet. So the mass flow rate in the nozzle, it is always a function of your pressure ratio as well as your area at outlet. Okay, now our aim is to find out the maximum discharge. How we studied in case of air compressor, that is minimum work done we have derived in case of air compressor. In the same way, so we need maximum discharge in case of nozzle. Okay, so for that, what you are going to do, just you are going to differentiate this equation with respect to p2 by p1. You remember, p2 by p1 is the most important term in the nozzle. You are going to differentiate this equation with respect to p2 by p1 and equate it to zero. So in case of air compressor, you equate it to zero for minimum work done. Here for maximum discharge, you are going to differentiate this equation with respect to p2 by p1 and equate it to zero. Okay, so just you differentiate. Okay, so you take the bracket only. Okay, just you differentiate that term, because only the pressure ratio is most important. You forget about the remaining term. Okay, differentiation of, you consider only this term. Okay, this is the most important term. Okay, forget about all the terms, just you consider this term, differentiate this term with respect to p2 by p1 and equate it to zero. That is differentiation of p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n minus of p2 by p1 n minus 1 divided by n. Okay, don't consider other terms, only you have to consider the whatever terms are there with related to p2 by p1. You forget about other terms. Okay, divided by differentiation of p2 by p1 equals to 0. So next, after this, and how we are going to differentiate. Okay, so 2 by n, 2 by p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n minus 1. This is similar to your recall your differentiation equation mathematics. Just 2 by n p2 by p1 2 by n minus 1 minus of this one n minus 1 divided by n minus minus becomes plus n plus 1 divided by 1 divided by n into the bracket p2 by p1 to the power of n plus 1 divided by n minus 1 minus 1. Just you understand the differential equation. Okay, differentiation of this with respect to p2 by p1, you'll get this expression. Okay, so after simplification, 2 by n into p2 by p1 to the power of 2 by n minus 1 minus of n plus 1 divided by n in the bracket p2 by p1 to the power of n plus 1 divided by n minus 1 equals to 0. Okay, next step is what I am shifting this term towards right hand side. Whatever minus is there, no, suppose if it comes to the right hand side, it becomes plus. Same thing I am writing in this equation. 2 by n in the bracket p2 by p1 to the power of, then you have to simplify 2 minus 2 by n minus 1 is nothing but 2 minus n divided by n. After simplification, this LCM, okay, equals to n plus, you take towards right hand side, so n plus 1 divided by n into p2 by p1. Once again, you have to simplify this one. N plus 1 minus 1 divided by n is nothing but what? Plus 1 minus 1 gets this one. No, n plus 1 minus n divided by n you'll get. So n gets cancelled. In the index, you'll get only 1 by n. Okay. Next, 2 by n into. Okay. So when you take towards left hand side, instead of n plus 1 divided by n, just you write it as n divided by n plus 1. Just I'm shifting this term towards left hand side. Okay, 2 by n into p2 by into n divided by n plus 1, and I'm shifting this power ratio, that is towards right hand side. Okay, so what this, instead of plus it becomes minus. Okay, just rearranging the term. This term you take towards LHS, and this term you shift towards RHS. 2 divided by n into n divided by n plus 1 equals to p2 by p1 to the power of, you instead of plus you take minus, minus of 2 minus n divided by n divided by n into this one. What is that? P2 by p1 to the power of 1 by n. Just you are rearranging the term and putting the ratio in one side. Okay, next you have to simplify. Okay, 2 divided by this n gets cancelled, you remember here. Okay, this n and this n gets cancelled, so you'll get only 2 divided by n plus 1. Okay, and once again this ratio is same. Once again you apply the law of index, that is nothing but x to the power of a into x to the power of b. So 2 divided by n plus 1 equals to p2 by p1. After simplification, just you simplify, you'll get n minus 1 divided by n. So my aim is to find out the pressure ratio. What you are going to do, just you have to divide the power by n minus 1 divided by n. So this is the expression. Okay, here in this equation, what I'm doing, I'm doing the dividing the power by n minus 1 divided by n. In that case, this becomes 1. Okay, p2 divided by p1 to the power of 1, and you have to divide the power of this term by n minus 1 divided by n is nothing but it becomes 2 divided n divided by n minus 1. So remember, this is the expression what we are getting. You are going to divide the power by n minus 1 divided by n. In that case, you will get p2 by p1 equals to 2 divided by n plus 1 to the power of n divided by n minus 1. You remember, you are going division. Okay, don't write as it is, because when you are going to divide, this becomes, instead of n minus 1 divided by n, becomes n divided by n minus 1. Okay. So this is the expression for pressure ratio for maximum discharge. You remember, this is the expression they'll ask in the examination. This is called as a critical pressure ratio. That is P2 by P1 is 2 divided by n plus 1 to the power of n divided by n minus 1. Okay, now very simple, what is our starting formula? M is what? A2 C2 divided by V1. Starting, we're having this equation. Okay, A2 C2 divided by V2. This is the expression for mass flow rate in case of a nozzle. Just now we derived the derivation for critical pressure ratio for maximum discharge. Okay. Now next step is for maximum discharge, what you have to substitute this value, that is P2 by P1. What is our formula? M equals to A2 C2 divided by V2. Okay. Now you have to express substituting in equation number 2. Okay. So this one, we are having the expression 6 as A2 by V1 square root of this one, 2 into N divided by N minus 1 P1 V1, what we obtained in equation number 6. And here in equation number 7, okay. Just what is the value of P2 by P1 is nothing but 2 divided by N plus 1 to the power of n divided by n minus 1 for maximum. What you are going to do, you consider the equation number 6, substitute the value of P2 by P1, what we get now, that is nothing but 2 divided by n plus 1, some value we got, that value you have to substitute in equation number 6. That is, you write A2 by V1 as it is, square root of 2 into n divided by n minus 1 as it is, P1 V1 as it is, and you have to substitute just whatever value you got just now, P2 by P1, critical pressure ratio, in this equation. Okay. Here, P2 by P1, what we are getting, you have to substitute in equation number 6 here. Okay. This equation. Substitute the value of P2 by P1, you call it as equation number 8. You have to substitute in equation number 6. Okay. So, A2. After simplify, just you go through simplify this equation, you'll get the expression as A2, you are getting A2 into square root of N into this value you are getting after simplification of this equation. This is what the maximum flow rate or mass flow rate in your nozzle. Okay. And one more equation is there, that is C2 max. C2 max is okay. Have understood little bit whatever I explained in the class. Okay, discharge through the nozzle. Anybody? Milan Chaudhary. Milan Chaudhary. Milan Chaudhary. Okay, guys, thanks for joining. Okay. I'll stop the meeting here only. Okay. Thank you, one and all. Okay. For joining. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
I had followed at least derivation, you understood. Okay, whatever I did. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Now, once again, you have to go through the. Once again, you have to go through the derivation. It is available in the books. Even I'll share this material with you. Just you go through once again. Try to understand this derivation as most important derivation. Okay, how to do the derivation? Okay. Okay. Thank you, one and all, for joining. Okay, we'll meet tomorrow once again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.